personally, me as a gay native two-spirit individual, in Navajo we call ourselves Nugle. And I was taught at a young age that I was seen special.
If you take the true sense of the word, two-spirit, meaning two spirits within one body, it's really, I think it's an honor.
We have a history, we have tradition, we have a culture that's been going on for thousands of years where we have been a part of everybody's lives in our tribe. My name is Ben Lucero Wolf. My Kiowa name is Otoko Ate, means with long black hair. I am a member of the Kiowa tribe.
My name is Richard Eric Dearmore, and I'm 28 as of right now. And I'm Paiute from the Eastern Sierras. It's Benton Paiute tribe.
I grew up in a place called White Horse Lake, New Mexico, which is maybe about 15 miles east of Chaco Canyon, the Chaco Canyon National Park, by my grandparents when my mother was in nursing school. At the time, my grandfather and my grandparents didn't have running water. We live in a traditional style home, which is called a hogan. The sustenance of life was sheep, growing corn. Living what I like to call now a simple life.
Growing up in a small town, which is way different than like growing up in LA where it's accepted to be whoever you are. Same with San Francisco, it's accepting to be different. And growing up differently, like growing up in a kind of conservative country town, you learn to be more conservative.
We didn't have access to the media, the television. We're like the last, and plus we living out in the country, we had no satellites. We didn't have electricity, so we didn't have a radio. We did have a truck and things. So growing up, when I was young, I just was as I am.
I had heard a story from my mother's eldest sister, who ended up playing the role of grandmother, if you will. And she had told me a story that I remember, that I recall, that long ago in the Navajo world, within the Navajo people, there was a separation of the sexes, and that there was an argument between man and woman. And then at that time, the men went to one side of the river and the women went to the other side of the river. And it was the Nugle, it was the more effeminate, less masculine men that brought the sexes together. And that because of the Nugle, that our people survived. If it wasn't for the Nugles, we wouldn't be the people that we are today.
Growing up, I was raised by my grandparents. My mom attended school, my dad and everything, but the grandparents were always there, so I ended up being raised. I knew something was different when I was young. Never knew about gay bars, gay things like that, where I live way out in the country, where Kiowas, and you know, we're poor people at that time, and still are, pretty much. And
I perform both roles as male and female. I help in ceremonies where I do more female roles. I help to cook, organize, and I also do more male roles where I'll haul wood, I'll chop wood, I'll bring in wood. But people see it as that special gift that we're seen to have, and it's really well accepted.
I never heard the term two-spirit while I was living in the Eastern Sierras, Reno, and that area. I never heard of it. I always just considered myself to be a gay male. And so I grew up that way until I got older, and then more towards when I moved to San Francisco, I started hearing that term more.
There was no official term, but it was just that they were as they were. It wasn't degrading. It wasn't humiliating. If you referred to them, you know, it was referring to just as a person, your family, you know, not a person, but a two-spirited person. They were just holy, sacred people, you know. That's how it was, you know. I think sometimes there was that change you could see as you're getting older and becoming a teenager, and you're starting to develop, and you start having an attraction to the same sex, you know, and stuff. And that was coming on, and I could see it, but I still didn't know.
My first time living away from the reservation, it was a big culture shock, yet I felt it important that I needed to continue an education. And so I went 5 years living in Phoenix and obtaining a bachelor's degree in sociology and American Indian Justice Studies.
Basically, because I just grew up in a small town, and then we moved to a bigger town, so I started growing, I guess, and then once I lived in a little bit bigger town, I wanted to do something more because I got tired of living there. So then that's when I moved to the bigger city of San Francisco. And then I've been in San Francisco for the last 2 years, like on and off for the last 2 years, and I kind of I wanted to grow more, and San Francisco is a little bit limiting, so I decided to come to LA and check it out and see what it's all about.
Remember going to my first gay bar? I came out to California to San Marcos, Palomar College down there. I was a freshman in 1979, I think I was like 17 years old. I remember that driving my dad's truck, I went into town over there and everything, and my dad was a professor down there at San Diego American Indian Studies. Well, I went to this area where there was a bar, and there were guys out there, you could see it, but I'm young, I'm 17, and I was kind of scared, but I met somebody. We didn't do anything, you know, but it was my first experiencing seeing two men together, you know, and then it kind of snapped in my mind, this is what I am, this is how I am.
I had never heard the word faggot until I moved away from the reservation. And that happened my first year of college when I was on campus, when a person looked at me and said, oh, you're a faggot. And I never heard that term used in that way, and it felt very demeaning. Because the way I was raised and the way I was brought up, being who I was, wasn't seen in any negative way or negative light, or there was no words that were used to say too many things like that.
I remember, you know, you get your high school senior yearbook, you go around, you pass the book around, have people sign it. I remember there was this guy, cross-country runner, and I like to run track and everything, and he was signing it. And he signed it, and I didn't read it until later, and it said to, no, wait a minute. He signed it in the class, and then he did something and rocked it, but he said to the nicest gay friend, you know. And then he took it back and he changed the A to a U, to the nicest guy friend, you know, like that. And it caught me then, because then I started realizing, what do people see? My grandparents come from traditional background, but they had a lot of Christian influence, you know, Baptist, Methodist influence, and Pentecostal and stuff. So we were around church, and my grandparents were like the first generations to really be involved in churches back then, you know. Hearing the religious aspects about being gay back then, it would tell you you're going to hell, you're being condemned. And then to try to understand that concept, what is that, you know? What is that, you know? Why would God do this to you, you know? Our Creator, our God. So I'm looking at it from a Christian point of view, a religious point of view, thinking, is it true? did you make this did you make me this way, God, that I one day will go to hell? And so no matter what I do or how good I am or try to be good and do the things that are pleasing to my creator, my God, that it won't matter that I'm going to go to hell because of who I am. And then I think, well, God, is it true that you knew my life before I took my first breath? Is it true that you knew already before I came out of my mom's womb, that before I was conceived, that you knew I was going to be gay?
I think American society is really caught up in the boxes and the labeling of who individuals are, and that the allowing of individuals to be who they are is not seen as socially acceptable. That we have to divide individuals in square boxes. Well, you're Native and you're lesbian, or you're bisexual and you're uncircumcised, you know, those type of things. That's American thought processes. That is something that has historically been ingrained in who we are as Americans. Yet when we try to take away from that and try to understand the Native, then we begin to understand really that these boxes never existed.
Most of us have now started kind of connecting to Christianity, you know, and that influence is very powerful. I'm not saying it's all bad or anything. I'm just saying to this part, it can be bad and it can hurt and it tears. I've seen it tear families up. I've seen some of the students that I work with in high school commit suicide, and it was really sad because there you are telling them, you have to love them. That's your children. First of all, our culture, we took care of each other. That's our children. You take care of them. But you got to love them for who they are, because this, in our own true traditions, our history, they are part of everything. That circle, they're connected. We are connected to one umbilical cord to everything, our Mother Earth.
Before colonization, we existed. We were a part of a community. We were a part of a society. There was no discrimination against who we were. There was no misunderstanding of what role we played in society.
We had one of the largest Indian education programs in the country. But I was released and terminated from my job because they used my sexuality. My boss, I think she became kind of afraid. She started telling some of our parents on our parent committee, powerful group, my friends, thank God. She started telling them, you know, Ben is gay. You know, he's gay. I don't think he should be working here, you know, and we should think about letting him go. Well, you know, he's really got to watch him, especially around those kids, especially the young boys. She was telling, but there I am at this time being a single parent of four boys, you know, and not realizing these are the comments going out there. So I was terminated. You know, all of a sudden, that was what came out of why I was being terminated. Although they were saying that I was not doing my job, I actually did a great job.
My older brother was diagnosed with HIV in 1996, just before I moved out here to Los Angeles. And I think he was diagnosed more so, now that I'm more educated about the disease, as having AIDS and actually Hep C as well. While I was out here during my first year of graduate school, he ended up passing, and because of complications to the disease. And I felt his presence. I felt I felt the need to be a part of this project because of him. And to see him having to go through issues on the reservation about having HIV, of being also a gay Navajo, two-spirit individual, but just to see the stigma that he had to go through, I think really helped motivate me in providing the services that I do for the clients that I serve, because I know they go through the same things that he went through.
Elton has developed this program here, and they've been really out there, very outgoing and really supportive.
Prior to working at APLA, I never had any gay friends. And it wasn't until I came here to APLA that I made significant friendships with individuals who were gay from other ethnicities. And so I felt the job that brought me here to APLA really balanced out my life personally as well as professionally.
I do feel inspired most of the time to want to do something and to be better. And I think it would be a great opportunity if I had the chance to join something like this and expand it to make it accessible to more people more of the time, I guess you could say. I think it would be something that I would totally be interested in. I've always felt like that, like I wanted to step up to a higher role in society. And I think that's part of my journey right now, is that exploring, like, you know, San Francisco, now coming here and seeing what there is and what I can do and what I, you know, what I feel like I am can possibly do.
I really enjoy when clients tell me that I have an impact in their lives. I really enjoy giving them a space and an opportunity to be who they are and to ask questions and to talk to each other, particularly in a large metropolitan area like Los Angeles, where, first of all, you don't find a community of Native Americans, and then second of all, you don't find a community of gay Native Americans. So bringing those two communities together for individuals, I think is really important.
Our Red Circle project, it's about that connection. Everything is that circle in life, you know, that connection, because we're all red men, so-called. But it's because that's what we're supposed to do, help each other.
Yo, hi, yo, hey, yo, hey.